Hello, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to Disability Viewpoints. My very special guest host today is Joan Willshire, and she's got some great guests coming up. My guests today are two OLA auditors from the Office of Legislature Audit, and they've audited Metro Mobility on a report which was released in late April. They'll talk about its findings, if they've heard from riders, what happens to the report next, and how the report information and data is used. Joan, your guests are.
Today we've got a great guest and the individual's director from the Olmstead Implementation Office. Believe it or not, Olmstead is turning 20 years this year in June, so we are going to talk about where it's come from and where it's going for the next 20 years.
Great, and we also have Trevor Turner from the State Council on Disability talking about a legislative update. All that and more next as the 25th anniversary year of Disability Viewpoints continues. We'll be back in a moment.
Minnesota and the nation will be celebrating 25 years anniversary for Olmstead this June 22nd. So we're excited today to have with us the director of the Olmstead Implementation Office, Aisha Elmquist. And I can't welcome you enough. Olmstead is one of my passions in disability issues. So we're thrilled to have you here today.
Thank you so much. I'm very glad to be here.
Good, good, good. And why don't we start off with how did Olmstead get created and the name and et cetera?
Olmstead, as you said, we get a lot of questions about it. And we love talking about the Olmstead decision because of how important it is. And also the legacy of the plaintiffs, Lois Curtis and Elaine Wilson, that brought the case behind the Olmstead decision. So we're coming up on the 25th anniversary of the Supreme Court decision, Olmstead versus LC, which is for Lois Curtis. And that decision is about the Americans with Disabilities Act. It says that under the ADA, people with disabilities, that means everyone with a disability, all ages have the right to live in the community when appropriate. And that also our plan and what we're talking about when we're talking about Olmstead is about services, where you live, employment, education. It has a broad scope when we're talking about Olmstead.
Right. Wow. Right. So it's because it really is looking at everything from housing, transportation, the human services, right?
Yes, absolutely.
All of it. And it was good to understand because when we talk about Olmstead, and it's STEAD, when it says the LC versus the EW, and those are the names of the two women that created this lawsuit, right? Started it.
Yes. Yes, it is. And it's unfortunate that it's referred to in short as Olmstead, because that's the name of the defendant,
right,
who was the commissioner that was sued in the case. Really, the legacy is about the two women that brought the case, right. Elaine Wilson and Lois Curtis.
Right. So let's talk about the first 25 years. What went on? What are some of the accomplishments? And then we can move into what about the next 25 years?
So our office works on something called the Olmstead Plan that has been in place for about 10 years. We're coming up. This is the perfect time to be having this discussion, because we're at a very exciting time where we are relooking at the Olmstead Plan and what that means for the future of Minnesota. For the past 10 years, we have been tracking different goals related to the heart of the Olmstead decision, which is about the inclusion, integration, and choice of people with disabilities throughout the entire state of Minnesota. And that's really what our work is about, is improving the lives, the quality of life of people with disabilities throughout the entire state.
So who can be considered one of the individuals that you would help relocate and into the community of their choice?
If there is a person that is in crisis or seeking help with respect to their individual situation, we would encourage them to contact Disability Hub to get connected to a variety of resources that may be able to help them with their individual issue. And our role is to look at the systemic issues that are happening or that are leading to exactly the type of situation you're talking about, which occurs all too commonly. So we are an interagency office, a small interagency office that works with a bunch of agencies to break down barriers and look at how can the agencies work together and work with people with disabilities to address those systemic barriers to integration, inclusion, and choice.
Right. So now let's kind of break it down even further. Let's talk about some of the important issues. Housing. I would imagine that's a big part because that's how people get stuck in a nursing home or in an institution because they've lost their housing. You have a bad car accident or a bad illness and you can't pay your rent, so there goes your apartment or your house. And then your stuff, you got to have stuff, and your stuff gets taken away and given away. Now you have no stuff. So talk about the housing piece here.
You're identifying something that happens all too commonly, and we've heard about for years through our office. And you're right, housing is an important piece of it. Education, transportation, services, so many issues. And we're at a phase with the Olmstead Plan right now where we have a variety of opportunities for people to tell us what should this next Olmstead Plan look like? What should the agencies be working on as top priorities into the next year, 2 years, 3 years? So right now is really when we are identifying those top priority issues. Housing, we know we will get comments on as a critical part of this. But we really want to learn from people with disabilities what the biggest priority area should be for us moving forward.
Right. Why don't we talk about another huge area is transportation. How does that impact people that are stuck in the institutions like a nursing home?
Transportation is such a big part of it, and that's why one of the agencies that we work closely with is the Minnesota Department of Transportation. We also work with Metropolitan Council. The current plan has some goals related to transportation, and we want to learn from people with disabilities, are those the right goals? What should we really be focused on as the biggest barriers that we need to overcome? And one of our opportunities is next month, starting on June 3rd, we are going to be launching a written survey through the rest of the month, asking people with disabilities about what our biggest priority areas should be for integration, choice, and inclusion. So encourage everyone listening to fill out that survey and also to sign up for our newsletter for other meetings and other opportunities that we'll have for people to offer input and also co-create the plan with the agencies that we're embarking on.
Wow, well, that's fantastic. So it's a huge action plan here that everyone, people with and without disabilities, can be a part of, right?
Absolutely. Our survey is open to anyone. We especially want to hear from people with disabilities. Anyone can take our survey and give us ideas for how we can do better as a state on these goals and really the heart of what the Olmstead Plan is all about, which is that inclusion of people with disabilities into the community.
Now, is there an actual 30th anniversary party or some kind of notation of an event of some sort?
Yes, I'm glad you asked. Okay. Our office is having a event, and it is a virtual event on Tuesday, June 25th from noon to 1:30. And check out our newsletter. We'll have a lot of upcoming information about that celebration of self-advocates who've been at the heart of the movement.
Okay. Do you have a website or phone number that people can catch up with?
Yes, we do. Our website is mn.gov/Olmstead. And that's OLMSTEAD. So a little different than the county. And our phone number is 651-296-8081.
Fantastic. Well, thanks so much. You've been a great guest. And we, especially I do, look forward to seeing all this great stuff coming out about Olmstead so we can help people get out of those institutions. So thanks so much.
Thank you.
And we'll be right back after these messages.
Welcome back to Disability Viewpoints. I'm Mark Hughes. With me are two distinguished guests from the OLA Audit Department. The OLA Audit Department recently released the end of April 2024 comprehensive audit on Metro Mobility. Metro Mobility, to a lot of us in Twin Cities who are disabled, is our lifeline as far as transportation. And so I'm going to let the two distinguished guests that are here today introduce themselves, because they're going to carry the show and be the celebrities. So,
thank you. My name is Jodi Munson Rodriguez, and I'm the Deputy Legislative Auditor for Program Evaluation.
Great. And you are?
And I am Mariyam Naadha, but I go by my last name Naadha, and I was the manager for this evaluation of Metro Mobility.
Sounds very good. Can you tell us a little bit about your office, which is the OLA, and why you completed this report?
Yeah, absolutely. So for those of you that aren't familiar with OLA, we're a nonpartisan research office in the legislative branch of government. We do financial audits, and we also do program evaluations. And that looks a little bit more into how effective and how efficient our programs and policies. And so with that, the topics for those evaluations get selected by the Legislative Audit Commission. Mm-hmm. So we don't select those topics. Legislators do that for us. It's a 12-person commission.
And that's a fair and balanced approach.
It is. So we have both bicameral and bipartisan representation on that commission. So it's 12 folks mm-hmm. who get together, and they have to agree on what they want us to look at.
Okay, good.
And Metro Mobility has been on the list of things to look at for several years, but we often end up with a list that's 100 long, and then we have to shorten it to five or
right,
six.
Right.
And so this year it finally did make it to the top. We had a number of legislators who told us they'd been hearing some concerns from their constituents, and so they directed us to do this report.
Wait, you've had in this audit that was recently released at the end of April several findings and recommendations in your report. How did you develop those, and did you include any rider perspectives in your research?
Thanks. Yeah, we did. Absolutely. So we tried to get the rider perspective in various ways. One way was by doing a survey of all of the current riders for whom Metropolitan Council had email addresses. Mm-hmm. We also put a survey up on our website so anybody who is interested could take it. They could share it with whoever they wanted to so that we could get perspectives that way. We got a lot of emails, phone calls, and then we also met with the Governor's Council on developmental disabilities, some folks from that council to talk to them. And then beyond getting rider perspectives, we also did a lot of data analysis. We looked at contracts, we looked at policies, we looked at procedures. We just really kind of dug in there.
So as Jodi mentioned, we looked at a variety of different things, and our main findings really are that the Metropolitan Council applies different service standards to the two different Metro Mobility service areas. As you are aware, there is a federally mandated service area that is subject to federal regulations.
Right.
And then anything outside of that within the area required by state statutes is not where the federal regulations don't apply. So the council has different service standards, especially when it comes to ride scheduling for
right.
those areas. So for example, if okay. A rider requests a ride in the federally mandated service area, Trip providers are required to fulfill that request.
Right.
However, they're not required to do that for the state mandated service area, and therefore those riders are placed on standby. They're not guaranteed that ride.
Mm.
So we found that because of these different service standards, while the Metropolitan Council largely met the demand for services, it allowed trip providers to deny a number of requests.
Right. And I'm going to have to move quick. Our time is fleeting. Can you tell us what you have heard from the riders?
Sure. So overall, riders had a positive experience or positive responses to our survey questions, but there were some riders who expressed dissatisfaction with ride services, especially in terms of on-time pickup, on-time drop-off, how long they were spending on the buses. Mm-hmm. And some riders also shared their perspectives on some technology that's been used for Metro Mobility, for example, the GPS technology mm-hmm. on the buses, or the technology to be able to track their vehicle. So we kind of identify some of those things in our report as well. And
Great.
These are certain things that Metropolitan
Great.
Council is aware.
Great. So what are the key findings from your research, and where do you want people to take away from your report quickly?
Yeah, so as I mentioned, you know, because of these different service standards, the Metropolitan Council allowed trip providers to deny ride requests in the state-mandated service area. So while there were about 1.9 million rides booked and, you know, provided, the council allowed trip providers to deny about 5,000 ride requests in fiscal year 2023.
All right, and you looked at some other practices and other state practices. Can you tell us what you learned from your review?
Yes, we looked at a couple of strategies other paratransit providers have used in other states, and we outlined some of the pros and cons of that for the Metropolitan Council to try those things for Metro Mobility as well to improve cost effectiveness and service quality. And I would just say one thing I would highlight is other paratransit providers have used centralized reservation where the Metropolitan Council or another third party would be responsible for reservation, scheduling, and dispatch. And we identified that as potentially something that could help improve quality.
So what happens with your report recommendations now?
Sure. So we made recommendations both to the legislature and to the agency. The legislature has actually already heard the Senate Transportation Committee has had a hearing on it. We're really hopeful that they'll pick up some of our recommendations and do something with that in the upcoming year. And then the agency we also had recommendations for, we'll be following up with them in about 9 months.
Sounds
great. See where
they're at. Sounds great. And so now it's my turn. And I usually don't do this on the show, but I am a Metro Mobility user every day. I've had 5 accidents since about 22 and 23, total 5. 3, they hit my garage. 2, I went over in my wheelchair, lost 2 wheelchairs. And 1 was at 30 miles an hour. I suffered a concussion. I'm not saying this to make you feel sorry for me. It's a proven fact. The more you ride, things are going to happen. However, I feel they have shortened the driver's training time. Thus, these things happen. My back wheel wasn't fastened down right, and over I went at 30 miles an hour. And also, I thought I would hear from management to see how things were going. I didn't. And I thought I might even have a meeting with Chair Zelli. And that didn't happen either. I went down when they were going to shorten the service areas in some of the suburbs and did the public comment, asked the Met Council to call me back and give me some help on it. If I could take the city bus, I would. That didn't happen. I didn't get that either. So I have a few questions myself, and I'm sure there are other riders that do too. Well, it's still a service. It's not a perfect service, but it's a service, and it's better than nothing. But I have a little question as to, number one, how management facilitates, and number two, customer service. And that's all I'm going to say about it. So now we'll do the final word segment quick. I want to be sure that we don't miss anything that you might have wanted to say.
So I think one of the other pieces that we identified is there are several issues with the complaints process, which is broadly the customer service process that they have. And we identified several issues, and one thing being, you know, the role of trip providers in it. And our main concern is, our finding is that the way that it's currently structured, the Metropolitan Council may be not aware of all the complaints that they're getting because it is being fielded by trip providers.
Well, thank you very much. I hope to come back again. We'll be right back with more Disability Viewpoints right after this. I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome back to Disability Viewpoints with Trevor Turner here. We're ready to do the legislative update, nearing the end of our legislative session here in Minnesota. And so, Trevor, I'm going to let you go ahead and tell us about what's happening at the Capitol.
Awesome. Thanks, Mark. Thanks for having me.
You're welcome.
We are in our final week of the legislative session. The last day is next Monday, but functionally the last day will be this Friday because on Monday they're not allowed to do any actual official business.
Okay.
It'll mostly be, you know, retirement speeches and final kind of legislative pomp and circumstance, you know, for ending the session. But functionally, I think it'll be this Friday. They theoretically could work through the weekend, but I don't think that there's an appetite from the DFL, the trifecta, to work through the weekend. You know, busy weekend for graduations and things like that. I think a lot of legislators would like to be home in their districts for that. And so I think that we'll see the last kind of final things pass on Friday. you know, this being a policy year, they don't really actually have to pass anything. If you might remember the 2022 legislative session, they passed almost nothing, because they weren't able to come to agreement. But there's no incentive to necessarily have to pass anything, because in a budget year, if they don't pass something, then the government shuts down. But this year, you know, there's a lot less incentive to get things passed.
Well, there's a little more freedom.
And you're with the state council, and so they've worked on a lot of stuff, Metro mobility being one. And we just talked about that the last segment. And how about other stuff you're working on? What do you think people should look out for?
Yeah, one of the things that we're looking out for, one of the things that, you know, I think for sure will pass this session, is pretty much a done deal at this point, is the Minnesota RISE Act. So this is based off federal legislation called the RISE Act. And this would ensure better communication and better disability accommodations for students with disabilities in college at our institutions of higher education. And I'm really excited about that, because one of the number one reasons a student with a disability in college will drop out of school is because they aren't able to get the accommodation that they need to complete their coursework.
Right.
And what this bill does is that it ensures accommodations and makes sure that universities are adequately communicating with their students and ensuring those accommodations are being met and being granted. This will be a very busy week for the legislature, but we're hoping in the Human Services bill that there will be a task force on guardianship reform. You just had the Office of the Legislative Audit. They're also going to be looking into guardianship reform as well. And this is a really big issue. I mean, it was made big issue from some big cases like Britney Spears or Michael Orr, the movie Blindside is based off of. These are people who were subject to guardianship and had a hard time getting out of it. Right. And if a celebrity is rich and influential as Britney Spears or Michael Orr can struggle with getting out of the guardianship, then imagine what it is like for a regular person.
Exactly.
And so we're hoping to really look into a wide range of issues that impact guardianship. And so this bill, if it's fortunate enough to pass, the Council on Disability will be the convener, and we'll be able to deliberate over the next year or two to come up with the policy solutions that will hopefully improve guardianship and also help move people away from using guardianship as a tool to maybe something more like supported decision making. Because oftentimes, I think in Minnesota and across the country, actually, guardianship is overprescribed. And so a lot of people get put under guardianship when that's not really the appropriate thing for a situation.
Is there anything when session finally does get out that you'd be working over at the Capitol to firm up for next January when we begin the budget year? Will you be working on stuff there to?
Yeah, I've already started been looking at that because when, you know, we had our legislative agenda this year, and obviously we try to get as much as we can passed. You know, last year, I think we had like 18 items on our legislative agenda, and all 18 of them passed. It was a really impressive year.
But a little fast-paced.
Yeah, it was very fast-paced. So it's definitely a change of pace this session. And unfortunately, a few of our things didn't get passed, so obviously we'll be carrying those over to next year. But also, sometimes the goal of a legislative session, especially on a policy year, isn't necessarily to, you know, you would like to pass something, but, you know, sometimes it's about bringing awareness and educating legislators and getting some hearings and stuff on it so that you're in a really good shape for next year.
Is there anything else we need to cover quickly? Anything we might have missed?
I think that, you know, we talked about metro mobility and transportation. I think that's something that they're going to be really want to pay attention to this week. You know, obviously the state is trying to come up with a compromise with the Uber and Lyft bill, and that will impact a lot of people with disabilities. You know, the people with disabilities have been really centered in that argument and how it'll impact. And obviously we're trying to get, you know, wheelchair accessible vehicle provisions passed this session so that, you know, Uber and Lyft and other TNC companies will have more options for wheelchair accessible vehicles so that wheelchair users can actually use the service.
I think one of the state's issues is whether they can afford to run a system as we run it now. And so that's an issue too. And so that's something we need to watch out for. Anything else we got to cover quickly?
I think that, I'm looking forward to expanding our transit options. I think this year we've really highlighted a lot of the gaps in our transit system for people with disabilities. And so I'm hoping that we can continue that conversation going into next year.
Sounds very good. And we'll see you again real soon on Disability Viewpoints. Thanks for stopping by.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Have a good day. We'll be back in just a minute. Thank you.
A lawyer, a teacher, a warehouse worker, a fitness instructor, a software engineer. What do all these people have in common? Well, they are all Minnesotans who are blind, deafblind, or visually impaired heading to their jobs every day.
State Services for the Blind, or SSB, helps blind, deafblind, and visually impaired Minnesotans create a path to reach their career and employment goals. That might mean learning the skills of living well with vision loss, getting training in technology, developing a resume, finding an open position, or working with an employer to figure out some job accommodations.
At SSB, customers set their career goals, and we provide training and resources to help Minnesotans achieve those goals.
An accountant, a baker, an office manager, a small business owner, a customer service rep, an architect. Blind, deafblind, and visually impaired Minnesotans are hard at work in all these careers and lots more too.
If you have vision loss and are looking for work or looking to advance in your career, just give us a call at 651-539-2300 or visit mnssb.org. State Services for the Blind, Independence, Equality, Opportunity, Achievement.
Well, that was an action-packed 30 minutes of Disability Viewpoints. We hope you'll join us next time for more Disability Viewpoints. Joan, you had a great guest today, 20th anniversary of Olmstead.
Well, we've learned a lot of where we've been and where we're going to be going. So it's exciting news. And the main thing, we want people to understand why Olmstead is important for everybody to know about and to know of its importance. So I think we've got a great show for people to be watching down the road as well.
My OLA guests were great today, and let me be clear that Metro Mobility is the main thoroughfare for a lot of the disabled community in the metropolitan area to get to and fro their doctor's appointments, errands, work, anything like that. However, every once in a while, the OLA has to give it a checkup and do an audit, and there were findings this time that we feel needs to be addressed and some corrections made. And so I'm sure there'll be a follow-up on this as things develop. The information now and the data is being passed along, and we'll keep you posted here on Disability Viewpoints as those things take shape. So for Joan Willshire and the entire team here at SPNN, I'm Mark Hughes. Thanks for watching Disability Viewpoints now in our 25th year, and appreciate your support. Thank you very much. Bye for now.